Is Fire Emblem anti-gay? No. Thanks for watching. Seriously though, of course Fire Emblem isn't anti-gay, but I could see why you would think that. I certainly thought that for quite some time, but I don't necessarily think that anymore. I want to take you through my journey with a couple different games and show you how I came to this conclusion. Just as a disclaimer, I'm going to be saying gay a lot in this video, but really what I mean is the entire LGBTQIA spectrum, but gay is so much easier and shorter to say than all those letters, so for the sake of the length of the video, I'm just going to be saying gay. So I think Alpharad put it best when he said,
"Look, I get it. You're tired of Fire Emblem. A beloved series to all has now been tarnished by waifu culture. Fire Emblem used to mean something, but now it means two things."
Now, he was obviously joking, but he's sort of right. Fire Emblem is a tactical role-playing game, similar to nothing really other than Dungeons & Dragons. Maps look like chessboards, and combat plays like rock, paper, scissors. But like any gaming franchise that lives longer than two or three console life cycles, it was bound to evolve. Enter Dating Mechanics, a game that used to be all about this. Now, more often than not, looks more like this.
"So, you don't have any weaknesses after all. I'm totally envious of you." "Incredible."
Now, this isn't a bad thing, far from it, in fact. Fire Emblem games were getting stale. Recycling the same old formula was getting tiring, so it was a relief when they chose to put something other than just combat and dialogue into these games. But with any game that includes dating mechanics, no matter how subtle, the same question always shortly follows. But do they let you be gay in this game? But before we get into the games that had these features, let's talk about everything that came before them.
Here I go, here I go, here I go again, girls, what's my weakness? Okay.
The first game to introduce dating mechanics was a game called Tokimeki Memorial. Yeah, I've never heard of it either. And why would I? It looks like it never made it to the West.
"I like the way you work it. No diggity. I thought to bag it up. Bag it up."
The first video game to include dating mechanics along with RPG mechanics was a game called Sakura Wars. This one, I've heard of. I've just never played it. Too bad, it looks like it was released on garbage, trash, Windows, trash, and the PlayStation 2. Oh, hang on, wait a minute. Russia?! From what I can tell, it did a pretty good job of balancing dating and combat, where if you progressed well enough in the dating portion, combat will become a little easier, which is surprisingly similar to how modern games do it. But let's ask the burning question, can you be gay? No. This game came out in 1996, and beyond that, it was like, hey man, we like just introduced dating into video games. Let us figure out how to do hetero dating properly first, okay? Cool. But we're not talking about Konami or Sega. We're talking about Nintendo. When it comes to things like swearing and being gay, Nintendo's kind of like a church. I know that sounds a little weird, so let me explain. When I was younger, I went to this church. To me, it was always like this nebulous hangout spot that was at the crossroads between school and home. If you cursed outside of church property, they didn't really scold you, they just looked the other way. Like, hey, we're not your parents. They would do the same thing about being gay. The Bible says don't be gay, probably, I wouldn't know, I never read the damn thing. But if it was ever brought up, they'd just look the other way, as if to say, I mean, we can't stop you from doing something you're gonna do anyways. And that's kinda how Nintendo acted for a while. Not actively trying to avoid putting gay in their games, but not actively putting it in their games either. Tomodachi Life sticks out to me as a game that stirred controversy among Nintendo fans. You could do so many things in this game, except be gay. They said you could be gay in the sequel, but that never came. And this game came out in 2013. But let's go back a bit. Fire Emblem The Binding Blade was released for Game Boy Advance in 2002 and was the first game to introduce support. It was the game with
Roy!
Support works like this. If a unit is on a space next to a unit who's currently in battle, support between those two units grows. Keep doing this and eventually your support level levels up. There are three ranks, C, B, and A rank. Achieving a new rank results in a support conversation between the two characters in question. These conversations would usually introduce and further small side stories between the characters, acting as the various C plots throughout the game. This, like combat, would be expanded upon in later titles. All this talk's making me curious. I wonder who the first gay Nintendo character was. Let's see here. Wow, this is a short list. Oh, hang on. Wait a minute. Ike? From Fire Emblem Radiant Dawn?
Prepare yourself.
Yes, that's right. We like Ike. Mr. Fire Emblem is permanently in Smash Bros. Now. Get over it. Himself is gay. But he's 2005 gay and takes a Dumbledore approach. You know, the, oh, really? That character's gay? I mean, I guess they are. They don't act it and never said they were, but sure, I'll take it. Phrases like most likely and heavily implied being thrown in Ike's general direction. Basically, the story goes like this. Ike is apparently very handsome, and a lot of female members of his group long for him, but he shows no interest. He does, however, show interest in his longtime friend and advisor, Soren. If Ike achieves a high enough support level with Soren, Soren says, "There's only one place for me to be, Ike, and it's by your side." Now, this just sounds like friends being nice to each other. However, when you take this support conversation across the Pacific Ocean, it translates to Soren saying, "You are the only one that is special to me." Okay, we're getting there.
Get your sexy on.
I'm bringing sexy back.
Yeah. The last bit of trivia hinting at the hero's homosexuality comes from the sequel, Fire Emblem Path of Radiance, for the Nintendo Wii. There's a difficult-to-unlock hidden skit in this game in which Ike and Soren embrace one another. This moment is then referenced in a Fire Emblem book, which states it as the moment where their two hearts became one. Now that's what I'm talking about. Does it let you be gay? Yes, but did you see how many hurdles we had to jump through? Not only is it barely hinted at once in the first game, but in order to get that hidden skit in the second game, you have to have already beaten the game once, have imported a save file from the first game in which Ike and Soren have already achieved an A rank, have achieved an A rank in the current playthrough of the second game, unlocked all of Ike's sealed memories, and kept Soren alive throughout the whole game. This was the beginnings of my suspicions with Fire Emblem being potentially not quite gay-friendly or welcoming to gay cultures. When your one gay scene is that well hidden, it almost feels like they were trying to hide it. Like, they had to hide it. As if maybe one of the developers wanted to include it, but someone higher up was telling them they couldn't.
Hey, I just met you.
Flash forward to 2012 and Fire Emblem is back, baby! Fire Emblem Awakening. I never played this game. I would have, but it came out at a time where I wasn't really playing 3DS all that much. AKA before Pokemon X and Y were released. Listen, I'm a simple man. Pokemon or Smash Bros. Says jump and I ask how much? Fire Emblem Awakening introduced S-Rank support. Achieve this and you get one of these! Yep, you guessed it. S-Rank is the romance option. And if you get a male and female unit to S-Rank, they have a child who fights alongside them in battle. Yay. But can you be gay? No. Their reasoning was, if you could be gay, you would miss out on the various children units throughout the game. But that wouldn't be so bad. I mean, those units are optional anyways. Some fans were, as you can almost certainly guess, unhappy. Finally, we get to talk about a game I've actually played. Fire Emblem Fates. This game took the Pokemon approach, where there were two games, Conquest and Rebirth, and depending on which one you played, the story and units would be different.
Yeah, you're looking at the truth, the money never lie, no.
So there was this spin-off game, Fire Emblem Warriors. It's basically the exact same thing as Hyrule Warriors. It's a Dynasty Warriors game, but with a Fire Emblem skin. In that game, Camilla from the Conquest House and Sakura from the Rebirth House get a little flirty in their support conversations. So I thought, when I play Fates, I'm going to pair these two together.
Girl, you don't want, I want to move it.
Being out of the Fire Emblem game for a while, I just assumed they'd let you be gay. But boy howdy was I wrong. Does it let you be gay? Yes. But only the main character, Corrin. I guess that makes two gay characters in Smash Brothers? Maybe three if you count Sonic?
Never mind.
Okay, that's fine, I thought. Then I'll just pair her with Camilla. I had chosen to start with Conquest, and I usually play a girl character anyway. But wrong again. There's only two units that can be gay in this game. Niles and Rajat. But it goes even deeper. Rajat is not only missable because she's one of these, but only available in Birthright, while Niles is primarily only available in Conquest. I say primarily because you do eventually get the opportunity to recruit him, but the game's nearly over at that point, and you wouldn't have enough time to build enough support to reach an S rank before it was over anyways. So with the only gay option being in Birthright and the only lesbian option being in Conquest, I was locked out of making the main character gay. If you remember, I mentioned playing as a girl character, but I actually had a reason for it this time. Look at the box arts. Do you see what I see? Female Corrin is on the box art for Conquest, while male Corrin is on the box art for Rebirth. I thought I was doing the right thing by picking female Corrin. She's on the cover. I figured canonically, female Corrin is in Conquest and male Corrin is in Birthright, and I can only assume others who bought both versions thought this way as well. Once again, we had to jump through what I would consider too many hoops to ultimately land on a gay Fire Emblem character. Why the struggle? Why the hiding? And while we're at it, why these two characters specifically? Niles is a thief who is described as sadistic, cold, and callous. His Wikipedia article even goes as far as to state that he derives pleasure from watching people suffer. And Rajat is a self-described loner, wishing others would stay away from her, especially those of which she shows no interest. There's a plethora of characters in this game, and they all have different and unique personalities. But if you want to be gay, you're stuck with either the best Fire Emblem character's creepy dead, or a wannabe thought. Seriously, these two pictures are of different characters. How'd they get away with this? So in between coming up with the idea for this video and actually sitting down to write it, a new Fire Emblem game came out, and it is incredible. And before you even ask, I am more than happy to announce that this game does in fact let you be super gay. There are 5 lesbian options in the game and 1 gay option. A new record. Now, besides the initial, seriously, what's up with that? This is a huge step in the right direction. And they're not hiding it either. All 6 units are available from the start, assuming you pick the right house. The best house in the game is Black Eagles. Yeah, that's right, I said it, don't at me, but it's also the most gay. 5 out of the 6 options are available if you take this route. Let's break these characters down real quick. Now, you're not going to romance these two because, like, just don't, leaving us with these 4. Now, if it were just these two, I'd say we got the short end of the stick again. Mercedes is just boring, I'm sorry. Not only is she super religious, but from what I can tell, she's just sort of milquetoast? Look it up. And Linhart over here has exactly 1 personality trait, and that's sleeping. Sure, I can bend reality to my will and cast lightning from my skin, but all this battling is so boring. I'd much rather be sleeping. And then you get the cream of the crop. Edelgard and Dorothea. Ooh, there she is! The reason to buy this game right there. And now that it's been confirmed that more DLC fighters are on their way for Smash Brothers, I swear if Edelgard doesn't make it in. These two ladies are awesome. They're both confident and have intricate and highly engrossing backstories. Now this is what I'm actually talking about. When I started this game up, I played a girl like I usually do, and I was happily comfortable playing through the game knowing I had a very many gay options. Okay. And most of them were pretty cool. But real quick, what happened to the gay side of things? You mean if I play male Byleth, I can't date Ashe? You mean I can't date Claude? What the hell is wrong with you, developers of this game? Look at this man and tell me that he isn't a hunky twink.
You're a hard guy to grasp, you know that, Claude?
Oh, I disagree. I'd let you grasp me any day. My hand, my heart, even my neck.
God damn it! So, at the end of the day, and at the end of this video, is Fire Emblem anti-gay? No. Is Nintendo or the ESRB anti-gay? Probably not. And the more time that passes, we're most likely getting closer and closer to dropping that probably. It's 2019 now. Video games, and the world, is currently the gayest it's ever been. And I know it's silly to say it like that, but you know what I mean. More people are accepting of different lifestyles and choices now than they've ever been. I probably would have been terrified to make this video back in 2012, and even still a little hesitant to make it in 2015. And all I have to say is, I can't wait to see what the future holds. For Fire Emblem, for Nintendo, for video games, and for us. I've been Thunder. Take it easy, guys. Hello, and thank you for watching. If you liked this, we have plenty more videos for you to check out. We just analyzed the new Star Wars trailer, and we recently did a video dissecting part 3 of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. If you like what you see, please be sure to subscribe. Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got a little something I've prepared for you. I'm going to sing the entirety of the Fire Emblem theme song. Here I go. Fire Emblem.